Testing.
Good morning, church. Great to see everyone. We're glad that you could join us this morning. And if you're online watching us, we're glad that you can join us this morning as well. We welcome all to this time of worship of our Lord Jesus Christ and a gathering of the people of God in His name. If you would like to connect with us, and we would love to connect with you. We have two ways to do that. One is coming out to our patio after our worship service to talk and share some nourishment together. Or online, you can go to our website and learn all about us, and or you can come to worship at 10 o'clock every Sunday morning right here at Grace Presbyterian Church. We'd also like to remind you that your gifts of love and thanksgiving to God are helping our ministry to flourish, and it's going really well, so thank you so much for your giving. We're still not passing plates in the live worship yet, so if you have an offering to give, the plates are back there on the tables, and you can just drop it in there. We'll have a moment to thank God for all His good and perfect gifts. And then we have a special announcement about our after-school program that'll start up in September, and I would invite Karen Campbell to come forward to talk a little bit about that. Welcome, Karen.
Good morning. Good morning, family. Good to see all of you. Still people coming in at the back, so it's always nice to see your faces after all this long period of time. I have with me two backpacks, just so sometimes the visual is important for you to see it. There's going to be a pancake breakfast. Maria, our food ministry person, is inviting families to come on, I think there's a slide, on the 21st of August. It will be from 9:30 to 10:30. And at that time, she's going to be giving out backpacks to our community kids. And so we're asking you to think about donating either a backpack filled with school supplies, or you can also, if you want us to do the shopping for you, which we're really good at, you can just put a donation made out to Grace Presbyterian Church Food Ministry Program in the offering plates, either this Sunday, next Sunday, or drop it by the church. There is on the back, two sides of the back door, or front door, depending on which direction you're coming and going. There's a flyer that lists items that you can put in these backpacks, and that these backpacks, it gives you more information, and when they can be dropped off during the week. In the fellowship hall, the food ministry people will be here giving out food on those days. I think that's all, except the deadline is August 18th, which doesn't give you very much time. So think about it, pray about it. This is a wonderful outreach program for our kids. Many of these kids in this community attend our after-school program, and so one of these backpacks will most likely be going to them. I put, just real quickly, I selected backpacks that were non-gender, so they could go to any kids, easier for us to hand out. But I did put a little card on them, letting the person who's giving them out know the grade level. I don't have things for preschool kids in this backpack. Mine are third through fifth grade or even higher than that. So if you can help us out, thank you so much. It should be, I think.
Yes.
The slide is up here, so I think it's gone out. Yes, Patrick.
Repeat the question.
That's a good question. It depends on the price of backpacks. I can just tell you, this backpack was about $15, these two backpacks. And at Walmart, I filled them with items. It's probably about $20, $25. I would say $25.
Okay.
But less than that is fine, because we can put those, you know, that money together and put together a nice backpack. And some backpacks you can get for a good deal, too. Be a good shopper. All right?
Okay.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, Karen. That's one of our ministry missions here in Vista that we support through our giving of our tithes and offerings. And it's great to hear how God's word goes out through your love of him and these people that we get to minister to. All right. So this is the day that the Lord has made. We're going to rejoice and give thanks to him. I invite Elder Patrick Ryan to come forward for our call to worship.
Thank you. Our call to worship this morning comes out of Psalm 119, verses 33 through 38. I'm reading out of the New American Standard. Teach me the way of your statutes, Lord, and I will comply with it to the end. Give me understanding so that I may comply with your law and keep it with all my heart. Make me walk in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to dishonest gain. Turn my eyes away from looking at what is worthless, and revive me in your ways. Establish your word to your servant as that which produces reverence for you. It's the living and active word of God planted in our hearts that produces the reverence for the Lord that leads to wisdom. Join me in prayer. Oh, gracious and holy God, give us diligence to seek you, wisdom to perceive you, and patience to wait for you. Grant us, O God, a mind to meditate on you, eyes to behold you, ears to listen to your living and active word, a heart to love you, and a life to proclaim you through the power of the Spirit of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. So to begin our worship, we have this song about coming to the river, the living water that feeds us and nourishes us through the Holy Spirit and Jesus, the Word, living Word of God.
Standing, please. It's a shorter one, I promise. Only 18 verses.
And everyone smile.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, into my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And a light unto my path.
Thank you, ladies, for leading us in that, and you may be seated. You know, there's so much that we can be thankful for in being in the United States and being able to worship our God in freedom. But we've noticed that a lot of the foundations of our nation founded on biblical principles, things have been slowly forgotten and taken out of the public square. Scripture, the Word of God, is so important within society and to be known and shared and encouraged among us. So I thought today we would look at the living and active Word of God. One of the promises of God's Word that He gave to us, that it's sharper than any two-edged sword. But before I do, I'd like to share a little story. I heard from pastor and author John Piper in his book Desiring God. Tells the story of back in 1918 of Tochiki Ishii, a Japanese man who was a very notorious man. And for 20 years, he was in and out of prison and until finally he murdered another man and was in prison waiting his sentence when two Christian missionaries, Western missionaries, Miss West and a Miss McDonald, went to visit him, and they handed him a New Testament. And he began to read the story of Jesus, his trial and execution. His attention was riveted by the sentence where Jesus is hanging on the cross, and Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Now, this sentence transformed his life. He wrote in his book before he was hanged for his crime, "I stopped. I was stabbed to the heart as if by a 5-inch nail. What did the verse reveal to me? Shall I call it the love of the heart of Christ? I do not know what to call it. I only know that with an unspeakably grateful heart, I believed." Tochiki was sentenced to death, accepted it as fair, impartial judgment of God. But in the days before his death, his faith sustained him by the words in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 10, "As sorrowing yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich." These words moved him deeply, and he wrote these words, "People will say that I must have a very sorrowful heart because I am daily awaiting the execution of the death sentence. Well, this is not the case. I feel neither sorrow nor distress nor any pain. I am definitely happier than I was in the days of my sinning when I did not know God. Perhaps in the future someone in the world may hear that the most desperate villain that ever lived repented of his sins and was saved by the power of God and the power of Christ, and so may come to repent also. Then it may be that though I am poor myself, I'll be able to make many rich." Wow. God's word is powerful. It's able to change hearts dramatically And even those who are extremely evil, we never would have guessed that they would come to Christ and their lives would be changed. So let's read Hebrews 4, verse 12 together. And we're going to have it up on the screen in a second, but I encourage us to read it out loud together. But before we do, let's pray. God, we thank you for your Spirit and for your love that reaches out to us through your word. And we pray, God, that these words that we're about to read will touch our hearts and change us, that we might go back out into the world encouraged to preach and to teach and to speak and to act according to your word, that others might know and be set free from sin. In Jesus' name, amen. So hear the word of God. Actually, let's read it together out loud. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. May God bless to us the reading of his word. I'd venture to say that every one of us has had moments when the Bible came alive to us, like the word just jumps off the page and we feel that God is speaking directly to us. Or we've sat in a worship service where the preaching of God's word has touched your heart, has informed you in such a way that your life was never the same after that. Becoming Christians, we had to accept the truth of the Bible and to believe that it is God's word. We came to understand that God's Son, Jesus Christ, is alive and is God's good news message of salvation to all the world, that our sins can be forgiven, that our lives will live eternally with Christ and one another. Well, somewhere in our history, we came to this realization. God's word was compelling, caused us to confess and repent and to turn over our sins, place them at the foot of the cross where they belong, and receive God's transforming forgiveness and love. Now, there was a yielding to the belief in the scriptures that we gave by faith. We believed by faith. And in that moment, God's word formed us. It changed us. Well, the writer of the Hebrews was trying to make his point loud and clear throughout chapter 4. And he wrote about entering the rest of God. In other words, the salvation peace that God has to offer in any circumstance. It's beyond understanding, as Paul talks about. God's peace. It protects our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. It's peace that no matter what we experience in life, we know that God has us in the palm of his hand. If we want to find truth and true rest and happiness of soul in all circumstances, then we must allow the living, active Word of God to penetrate our unbelief and speak to the very depths of our soul. There's no other way to know the plan of salvation which God has revealed to us and to the world than through God's word that's contained right here in the scriptures. That word is given to us in written form. It's also given to us in living form, our Lord Jesus Christ, the Logos of God. That's a reference to the very first verse of John's gospel. You'll remember, in the beginning was the Word. That's Logos. That's translated there. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. Now we must seek the written and living Word of God, otherwise we are on a dark highway of life with no clear direction. God's Word is not outdated. It's not antiquated, as so many in our society want to declare. It is forever living and interactive with anyone who hears it. Through God's Word, we live. We have breath, and we have being. So in addition to the word being living, it is also active. Remember that God's word spoke creation into being. He spoke, and there was a division of firmament and water and heavens, and there was the creation of animals and human beings. God's word gives direction to the lost. The scriptures are not static, black ink on a page, but they become active words in our hearts as it speaks newness of life to each one of us. God's word gives new names to his people, and they are transformed. Jacob became Israel. Simon became Peter. Saul became Paul. And they lived into those names. When God speaks, nothing remains the same. Hearing and seeing God's word is hearing and seeing it spoken directly to us. The scriptures invite and even implore us to dialogue with God as we hear his word, to say, Lord, I don't understand this. Or, wow, God, I worship you because of this. Help me understand. Help me where my faith is weak. Give me strength, O Lord. Scriptures invite us to dialogue, to converse with, to allow God's word to form us. Hear how the word of God is actively at work from the Apostle Paul's point of view. He wrote in 2 Timothy, all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training for righteousness, that the person of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. You know, the reformers of the 16th century, you remember Martin Luther, John Calvin, placed the scriptures as the highest authority for faith and works. They believe that it becomes active for its readers through the presence of the Holy Spirit. Not only was the Holy Spirit working through those who penned the works, but the Holy Spirit works through the heart of those who read it and to understand it. The Reformers spoke of the necessity for the unity of the Holy Spirit and the biblical word, and only this unity is the divine criterion for faith. Here's an example from John Calvin. The truth of Scripture cannot be discerned as the Word of God apart from the sealing of the Spirit, which imparts to the conscience of believers such certainty as to remove all doubts. Now, this is illustrated by John Piper, who stated that the pursuit of joy in God through reading the Bible is part of our highest aim. He writes in the book Desiring God, we are to pursue this joy like Christian hedonists. Are we to throw the kindling of God's word every day on the fire of joy? Indeed, we are. Not only every day, but day and night. And then he quotes from Psalm 1, the first couple of verses, he says, which say, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. And Piper adds, not to pursue our joy every day in the word of God is an abandonment of the revealed will of God. Yet another way to see God's active and powerful word at work is how Jesus resisted Satan's temptation by using the word to repel the devil after his 40 days of fasting. If you turn to Matthew 4, verses 3 through 11, it reads, the tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, and that's how the devil always comes to us. If you are, if you believe, then if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Jesus answered him with the word of God. It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written. Notice his ploy. He's trying to use scripture to persuade as well, deceiving. He will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus answered him, again with scripture, it is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give to you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. And Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. And here we can see how the Word of God is active. It's living. It forms. It informs. It rebukes. So being armed with the Word of God has been the secret of God's great spiritual warriors throughout history. Here's one example of a missionary by the name of Hudson Taylor, founder of the China Inland Mission. He knew how Satan wanted to destroy his joy in the Lord. He knew the importance of daily activity in the Word. So Taylor sustained himself through incredible hardships by disciplined meditation on the Bible every day. It is John Piper writes of him, well do those who traveled with Hudson Taylor remember how he took time for proper prayer and Bible study. He knew that it was vital. All night, when they finished traveling by cart or wheelbarrow or stayed at the poorest of inns, there was often only one large room for all of the party to stay together. They would screen off corners of the room for each of them, and late at night they would see a candle burning while Taylor studied and prayed. The time from 2 o'clock and 4 a.m. in the morning was the time he usually gave to prayer, the time he could be most sure of being undisturbed to wait upon God. You know, it is so important for us as we look at the ministry that God has entrusted to us and the community around us as we're trying to proclaim Jesus Christ. We've got to be in the Word. We've got to speak it. In every opportunity we get, the Word is active. It's living. It will change the world around us. It will inform us as we pray. Another way that the Word of God is living and active is illustrated in Jesus' parable of the sower. In Matthew 13, Jesus taught how the Word of God is proclaimed and received. The Word of God is actively spread throughout the world as seeds are sown. The seed of God's Word are cast about through our words, through our actions. Some people receive that seed of God's Word like hard soil. The seed doesn't penetrate them, and the devil snatches the truth away because it lies on the surface and has not penetrated into the heart. Some receive the word quickly and it takes root, but the soil is rocky. Their hearts are full of things and distractions and other things that don't allow the seed to grow deep into our souls and flourish. And so they wither and die. Others receive the word but allow the temptations of this world to choke it out, to rob it of its ability to grow and bear fruit. And fortunately, there are those of us who have good soil. We receive the word of God, and it grows and bears fruit in the form of changed lives that glorify God. That's when the living and active word of God recreates. It reconciles, it redeems, it restrains, it renews, restores, rewards. Well, there's a lot of rewords there, huh? But it's true.
Just how does God's word do all that? Well, that's what the next part of the verse declares. So in addition to the word of God being living and active, it is sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Well, God's word is like a very sharp sword, able to cut through tough, hard layers like a hot knife through butter, and it makes assessments about what is there. The word of God is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And when we read or hear the word proclaimed, it highlights what's really in our hearts. Where there is sin hiding in there, the word points it out. Sin is very good at masking itself so we can't see it. But God knows us better than we know ourselves. God's word illuminates our brokenness so we can repent and get rid of it. And the word of God penetrates our defenses and deceptions and exposes belief or unbelief like a surgeon cutting out cancer. The only reason we practice sin is because at some level, we are deceived to believe that it will be good for us. That's when we start believing the lies of sin instead of the promises of God. God whispers through the desires of the flesh and the rationalizations of the mind. Those lies sometimes lodge themselves very deep in the heart as thoughts and intentions that seem like unshakable truth because of the hardness and the deception that encloses them. That's what sin does. Our only hope is that there is something sharp enough and powerful enough to penetrate through all the deception and shed light on our thoughts and intentions. Word of God is our only hope. That's why Paul wrote in Ephesians 6 that one of the pieces of the armor of God that we should intentionally embrace before we go into ministry each day is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. We cannot advance the kingdom of God without that sharp and powerful Word of God as our weapon of choice. What do they say? A good defense is a great offense. It means we must be daily inputting God's Word to counter the world's continuous bombardment of ideas contrary to God's purposes. Now, that's why most Christians and most churches, especially Presbyterian branch of churches, believe that the reading and the preaching of the Word of God is the most central part of worship. That's why we put so much time into it. It's the only part of worship that we can trust explicitly. And even though the Word comes through the grid of human writing and speech and must go through the grid of human hearing as well, the Word is accompanied by the Holy Spirit. We can rest in the joy of knowing that as we seek sincerely to respond in worship of God's Word, whether it's sung, read, or preached, we are dialoguing with God Himself. You know, I'm often thanked as I'm greeting people after a worship service. Thank you, Pastor, for saying X, Y, or Z. And I'm thinking to myself, I didn't say that. Because God's Holy Spirit is interacting with each person individually, and what they're hearing is what God wants them to hear through His Word. It's amazing as God works through His Word to speak directly to each one of us. In fact, there are as many sermons being preached right now as there are people hearing it. Reading and preaching of the Word of God encourages us, it comforts us, strengthens us, challenges us to go back into the world from which we came to be a witness of God's message of good news and joy. Now, the Word of God is prominent in worship because it is the revelation of God Himself, and it brings glory to Him as we respond to the Word in worship. So in most Reformed churches, the time that we give to the reading and preaching of the Word of God is nearly 50%, sometimes more. It's time where God reveals Himself and His will to us, and it's a time to respond in our hearts as we are given that newness of life. That's why we generally put the offering after the preaching and the teaching of the Word of God, because then it gives us a chance to respond with thanksgiving to God. Our response takes the form of praise and prayers to God, either as confessions of sin, joyful adorations for His gifts to us, or commitments to change our habits and our behaviors. As the active, living, and penetrating Word cuts deep into the heart, we respond actively. And the only choice is for us to do other than that is to ignore the Holy Spirit's work, and that could be very costly, not only to us individually, but also to us as a church. Now, the point of hearing God's Word is to respond by yielding to His insights, repenting of sin, and being strengthened to do the work of the church. Our worship is centered on God revealing Himself to us again and again and again. Now, we may not remember every sermon that we've ever heard or every Bible study we've ever attended, but like eating a meal that we don't remember what was in it, it's life-sustaining. We can't do without it. God's Spirit makes sure that we get something, that we hear God's voice of encouragement and receive His direction. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, which we read also from Psalm 119. In conclusion, I believe that as the world has moved away from sin, away from the Word of God, they've removed the parameters of God's new life in Christ that is more loving, more kind, and especially more transformative, leading, guiding people in the ways of salvation and community that is together and loving and caring for one another. People today, I think, are really hungry for the truth that does not deceive or lead them into more misery and destruction. I think we need to have the Word of God back in our culture, back in our classrooms, back in our daily living. Pastor and author Ray Steadman wrote, "Plainly, Scripture is the only reliable guide we have to function properly as a human in a broken world. Philosophy and psychology give partial insights based on human experience, but they fall far short of what the Word of God can do. It is not intended to replace human knowledge or effort, but is designed to supplement and correct them. Human knowledge can never outstrip divine revelation." So with that said, I believe that the church should be working diligently to bring the Word of God back into our communities, into our neighborhoods, and into our families. We need to be missionaries, taking the living and active Word of God, spoken and heard, out into the world. It doesn't just reside here in this building, but goes with us. As we're transformed, as we're formed, and as we're excited about it, that wonderful relationship with God when He speaks to us and we share it with others. And that's a contagious kind of joy and living for Christ. The irony is that the Word of God is in most people's homes. It's the world's most sold book and easily available to us on the internet for free. There's no excuse for anyone who wants to read it. However, even with its availability, there's still the chance that it will have little impact on people's lives. Why is that? Well, one pastor wrote, "I think it's because people read the Bible with the word, with the wrong goal in mind. They read it like any other book, for information, but the Bible is screaming to be read not just to inform us, but to form us. So often we come at the Bible and try to master it, and what we should be seeking is to let it master us. We fill our heads with its knowledge, but we don't fill our lives with its power. We can name its characters, but we fail to let it develop our character. We take notes, but we don't take note. We read it, but we avoid being read by it. We interpret it, but we don't want it to interpret us. We exalt it, but we don't embody it. We have it, but it doesn't have us. So what is God speaking to our hearts today? Is he trying to form us by his word? Is God's powerful sword cutting and illuminating deep down inside of us? Is there brokenness that needs healing? Is there peace or a joy that needs encouraging? Is God calling us to something more important or renaming us to a new life? Is he calling us something to that is higher than anything that we've ever achieved or tried to do on our own? Any one of us who have taken God's word seriously knows that it is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, and that they can't remain the same. They have to allow God to transform by the renewing of their minds. Isaiah wrote, chapter 55, God speaking prophecy to his people. So shall my word that goes out from my mouth, it will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve, the purpose for which I sent it. God's word is going to accomplish what he wants it to do as we proclaim it, as we live it, as we are formed by it. Remember, God is the great creator. And he's always recreating, and he takes joy and delight in forming us and recreating you and me into his image. Amen? We're going to take some time and pray. There have been a lot of people that are in need of our prayers. Some of you are in need of prayer today. You know that one of our members passed away this week, yesterday morning, as a matter of fact, H.J. Young. And we want to pray for H.J.'s family and for peace, the peace of Christ and the comfort of Christ to be with them and all of their friends. So let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you, acknowledging that your word is been active and living within this hour that we've been diving into your word as we've heard your word spoken and preached and taught. And we pray, God, that what we have heard, what we sense your guidance to be for each one of us, what we sense for us as a community, to not return to you void, as you promised, that it will accomplish your purposes. We're so grateful for the living word, Jesus Christ, who has made it possible for us to be filled with you by the Holy Spirit through the forgiveness of sins and the new life we receive from him. So, God, we're thankful. We're grateful. Now we pray, God, that you will use us as you've commanded us to go into the world, to make disciples, to baptize them. And we know, Lord, that you will be with us always, even to the end of the age. So, Father, we pray as we go back into that world, our families, our neighborhoods, our communities, that you would show for us exactly what you would like us to do and who you want us to love and be there for during times of trouble and in times of joy. We pray for our nation, O God, that has slowly moved away from your word. We pray, Lord, that that will be reversed. We pray, God, that your word would go forth in this nation and return the nation to its roots, founded on the word of God, with all of the love and the kindness and the compassion that the word of God has that can form and change and cause to be. We pray, O Lord, for those who are struggling in this pandemic with the new variants that are coming out. We pray, God, for protection. We pray for deliverance. We pray, Lord, for an end to this, that we might gather freely again without the worries and the fears. And we're grateful, Lord, your word says that we don't have to be afraid because you are ultimately in control. And we lean into you now, Lord, for that assurance. And we remember the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In a moment, we're going to have a piano duet by Jane and Francis called Rejoice, Jesus Reigns. But this is a time to reflect also upon the word that you have just heard and God's provision for you and gifts to you, and respond with the giving of your hearts, your rededications, your recommitments, and your gifts to Him. So we'll dedicate the offering when they're done. And so welcome, ladies. We're so glad. We are so blessed. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you for the music department of our little congregation and just the joy that they bring to us through music that you've created and given to us. Thank you, Lord, that we can be reminded of all the wonderful gifts that you give us. And we pray thanksgivings now for these gifts and the return of a portion of these gifts to you for your purposes, dedicated for the advancement of your kingdom. And we pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
amen.
Let us stand and sing the hymn, How Firm a Foundation, together. Please be seated. As we close out our worship service today, we've sung How Firm a Foundation, which affirms our faith in Jesus Christ, the living word. And now we'll sing the song The Stand, which again affirms our faith that we'll stand on the Lord and who is always the rock of our salvation. You stood before creation, eternity in your hands. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failures and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon shoulders, my soul now to stand. So what can I say?
What can I say?
What can I do?
What can I do?
Let's stand together. So what can I say?
What can I say?
What can I do?
What can I do?
But offer this heart, O God, completely to you.
Make it a prayer. So what can I say? So what can I say?
What can I say?
What can I do?
What can I do?
But offer this heart, oh God, completely to
sing this song. We do offer our hearts to you. We know there is no better place to be than in your arms and standing on the promises of Scripture and receiving the forming, renewing, reclaiming, redeeming word into our lives. So Lord, we just recommit our lives once again. We turn them over to you, knowing that they're in good hands and that we can rejoice and live a life that is glorifying of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with everyone, both now and forevermore. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.